The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Grace and peace to everyone. In the name of Jesus Christ, we welcome you this evening to worship at Broadway Baptist Church in Fort Worth, Texas. We are delighted that you have gathered with us this evening on this Maundy Thursday, a most holy day in the life of the Christian calendar. We welcome you all. If you are visiting among us, either here physically in person or online, my name is Ryan Price, and I'm the senior pastor here. We are delighted that you are with us this evening. We like to say we are a church of both extraordinary worship and also extravagant hospitality, and we pray that you will find both of those things with us this evening as we come to worship God together. Welcome to you. Maundy Thursday is an ancient tradition. The word Maundy comes from the Latin word mandatum, which means commandment. And on this night, which we commemorate, Jesus gathered with his disciples in the upper room just before he was betrayed and gave to them and also to us a commandment that we are to love one another. So our deep, deep prayer is this evening that you would come into this beautiful sanctuary, either physically or in spirit, and be overwhelmed with the goodness and presence of God's grace in Jesus Christ, and that the love that we share together in the fellowship and communion of the Holy Spirit. It is a special night. We come both with word and table. This table is Christ's table, and it is open to all, as are our hearts also. And so then, as we prepare for this hour of worship this evening, I say unto you, lift up your hearts.
Please join me in the call to worship. A table is set before us. A feast is prepared for us. The Lord calls us to this supper of remembrance. As we break the bread and share the cup, but we will never forget Christ's example.
Pray with me. Holy God, on this Maundy Thursday, we ask that your Spirit come to us with remembrance and gratitude. May we remember Jesus in those last precious moments of his life. As we picture once again how he served his friends around a somber table, may we picture what the Messiah looks like. Help us to remember as we take the bread and the cup how his body was given and how the cup of his life was poured out. Let this inspire us to live as Jesus did, in giving of ourselves always in the service of others. In the example of Jesus, may we offer our bodies and our lives to you anew this holy night, trusting that you will guide us in the ways we might embody this greatest example of love. And fill us this night with gratitude, O God, for this incarnation of your Son. May we stand in awe of your wondrous love. It is in the precious name of Christ we pray. Amen. A reading from the Old Testament. The Lord said to Moses and Aaron in the land of Egypt, "This month shall mark for you the beginning of months. It shall be the first month of the year for you. Tell the whole congregation of Israel that on the 10th of this month, they are to take a lamb for each family, a lamb for each household. If a household is too small for a whole lamb, it shall join its closest neighbor in obtaining one. The lamb shall be divided in proportion to the number of people who eat it. This is how you shall eat it: your loins girded, your sandals on your feet, and your staff in your hand. And you shall eat it hurriedly. It is the Passover of the Lord. For I will pass through the land of Egypt that night, and I will strike down every firstborn in the land of Egypt, both human beings and animals. On all the gods of Egypt I will execute judgments. I am the Lord. The blood shall be a sign for you on the houses where you live. When I see the blood, I will pass over you, and no plague shall destroy you when I strike the land of Egypt. This day shall be a day of remembrance for you. You shall celebrate it as a festival to the Lord. Throughout your generations, you shall observe it as a perpetual ordinance. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God."
Thank you.
The epistle reading from 1 Corinthians. For I received from the Lord what I also handed on to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took a loaf of bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body that is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, he took the cup also after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Please pray with me. Gracious God, as those who strive to follow Jesus in our living and to trust your power in our dying, we gather to reflect upon the life that ended on a cross. We recognize in ourselves the strengths and the weaknesses of Jesus' disciples. Although they loved him, they disappointed and failed him. And yet, gathering with these imperfect friends at this last meal, Jesus washed their feet in service and then extended the bread and the cup to each. Jesus called them to love one another and invited them to share in his very life and in his acceptance of the road ahead. We are humbled, honored, and inspired by the deep love Christ extended to the world, and we take seriously the calling to be the body of Christ today. Please forgive us when we disappoint and fail you, and guide us back to a place of trust and faithful living. Grant us the vision to see the world as you see it, God, with love and compassion for all your creation. We ask this in the name of Jesus, who taught us how to live and how to love. Amen.
Thank you.
Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable and pleasing to you, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. The Lord's Supper is always a special moment in the life and work of ministry. We stand here at the table as the congregation comes forward, and we see the people of God filing forth. They come young and old, eager and haggard, anxious and fearful, and also full of joy and thanksgiving. Some walk, some roll, some shuffle with loved ones holding their arms for cautious care. Some remain seated, feeble, yet still full of hope and expectation that they too will be included. In this very room, I've served communion to some of the wealthiest people in the world, whose hearts were heavy with worry and sorrow. And I've served friends with street-soiled hands, yet whose souls were light and full of agape love. I see them all as they come near. I see you all. And I hope that you see each other, for that is a part of the meaning of the meal, to see each other. And in seeing each other, also to see Jesus, to love each other, and in loving each other, also to learn to love the world. And in learning to love the world, to love Jesus also. The scripture tonight comes from St. Paul's first letter to the Corinthians, right before the famous love chapter. It's quite a letter. Read it from front to back, and we see Paul was dealing with a lot when it came to that church in Corinth. There were divisions. Some in the fellowship were saying they were followers of Paul. Some were saying they were followers of Apollos. The sanctimonious said they were just following Jesus. Watch out for those folks. The community couldn't decide how they wanted to worship. There were arguments about the meaning of marriage, arguments about speaking in tongues, arguments over food sacrificed to idols, and even arguments about the Lord's Supper. The rich were showing up for the communion, eating all of the food and getting drunk on the wine, while the poor couldn't get off from the late shift and were left out completely. Folks were sleeping around. One man with his own father's wife. Wow. Some were suing each other. And there were bitter factions and rivalries all throughout the pews. But other than that, it was a great church. So the stewardship brochure said, because unity or not, I'm sure they still had rent to pay. And into all of this, Paul picked up his pen. And taking on the argument over the communion, he reminded the congregation what the meal was all about. And he appealed not just to human authority, but to what he himself had received from the Lord himself in a vision. For I received from the Lord what I also handed on to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread and broke it. And when he had given thanks, he broke it, saying, "This is my body that is broken for you." So Paul said the people needed then to examine themselves and not eat the bread without first discerning or thinking about the body. Think about the body of Jesus, Paul said. The body of Jesus, calloused in hand and worn of foot. The body of Jesus, bent in prayer. The body of Jesus, with hands outstretched. The body of Jesus, tortured and brutalized, sweaty and bloody, brown and bordering on black in the hot 9 to noon Passover sun. The body of Jesus, hungry. The body of Jesus, thirsty. The body of Jesus, beaten and dying. The body of Jesus, so full of heartache and humanity, suffering and salvation. Think about all of this and something else also, Paul said. Think about the fact that you are the body. Broken, suffering, struggling to get by, trying to make ends meet, trying to hold it all together, worried, fearful, frustrated, hurt, sad, and angry, and still hoping somehow to belong, hoping in and still somehow trying to be church. Two 2,000 years later, we are still trying, still struggling, still hopeful, yet also still uncertain. I see it in your faces when you come forward. Most of the people who are here tonight have been through the fire. You've had your hearts broken, and you know how difficult and disappointing this life together can be. Yet you are still here. And we are still here, and we are still coming metaphorically to the table Jesus has set before us, and we haven't given up yet on the things that he has taught us. "I give you a new commandment," he said on that last night, "that you are to love one another." That was the last thing he said to his disciples on that last night. And then, following saying that, he prayed for them. And he prayed that they would have unity amongst themselves. He prayed that we would be at one with one another, so that then the love with which God loved Jesus might also be in us. Love is patient. Love is kind. It is not irritable or resentful, and it does not rejoice in wrongdoing. These are the things that Paul said at the end of his letter to the church at Corinth, in which we read at just about every wedding we ever attend, right up at the altar. Perhaps we should read them also at the altar before the communion as well. A reminder again of what it's all about, what it cost, what it took, what it demands my soul, my life, my all. The command to love that Jesus gave is the most difficult command of all. It requires that we be patient and kind and long-suffering with one another. It requires confession and humility and a whole lot of forgiveness and learning to live with one another. It's the hardest thing to do in the world, to belong together. But Jesus believed in it so much, and he's still praying for it to happen. He's still praying for a community called love and a body of people who dare to keep on trying to put it into practice. In the bylaws of the first church I pastored, there was a reference to the Friday night prayer service, which was to precede every Sunday communion service. Somewhere over the course of the church's 150-year-old history, they had quit meeting on those Friday nights, probably around the time of the invention of the automobile and the picture show. Friday nights at the church just couldn't compete with Charlie Chaplin on the big screen. But something was lost when they gave up what they called the Friday night go-to-meeting. What was lost was the discernment of the body, the consideration of belonging, the confession of sins, and the reconciliation that needs to happen in spirit before one is really ready to come to the Lord's table. Discern the body, Paul says. Think on all that it costs for Christ's body to be broken and blood to be shed. And think also about what it means to belong to that body, fully and completely and in absolute love and solidarity and commitment and care. Think on what it means to be at one with one another in the love of God and the grace of Jesus Christ and the radical fellowship of the Holy Spirit, which connects and binds and bears all. The table is set, and we will soon approach. But before we do, we will practice the discipline of silence. We will extend that silence just a little longer this evening. For this is our time on this holy night to take the time to reflect and to consider, to discern the body, and to pray. What is the meaning of this meal, the young Jewish child asks at the table of Passover? Well, the meaning of this meal is love and solidarity. and sacrifice. His body was broken for us, and we belong to that body. Out of many, we are made one, milled together, as Augustine said, in the bread of our life together, in Christ. Bread of the world, in mercy broken. Wine of the soul, in mercy shed. By whom the words of life were spoken, and in whose death our sins are dead. Look on the heart by sorrow broken. Look on the tears by sinners shed. And be your feast to us as the token that by your grace our souls are fed. As we prepare ourselves now to receive this bread, let us take time to consider the meaning of this meal, to discern the body of our Lord in all of its suffering, mercy, self-sacrifice, and love. And let us do it all in remembrance of Him until He comes again. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, one God, Mother of us all, and all of God's people then said, Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give God thanks.
As I said at the outset of service this evening, this is the Lord's table, and it is open to all. And as a minister of God's good gospel for all of us, it is an honor to invite you to come and receive these tokens and signs of God's great grace in Jesus Christ, our Lord. Let us pray. Gracious One, now, having heard the examinations of our hearts and our minds and our prayers, we ask that you would meet us at this table with the grace that we need for this evening, for the journey that is ahead, for the darkness that is to come, and that you might be with us until the hope of resurrection comes. Meet us now, O Lord, with your Holy Spirit, which is here in the breaking of the bread and also in these, our beloved brothers and sisters and kindred in Christ. Amen. And on that last night, Jesus, after the prayer, took bread and broke it, saying, "This is my body broken for you. Take and eat."
And in the same way, he took the cup also after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes."
The table is set. We will invite the congregation to come forward row by row, as the Presbyterians would say, with decency and good order. And we welcome you. Come and receive this grace.
Thank you.
Let us join together now in the profession of faith. We remember his death. We proclaim his resurrection. We await his coming in glory.
Oh,
invite the congregation to join me in our congregational benediction. O God, Most High, on this night we remember Jesus humbly washing the feet of his disciples. Jesus has set us an example for us, especially those in need. Jesus has set an example for us. Help us to follow him. We pray for peace among nations and religions, and peace among people. Jesus has set an example for us. Help us to follow him. We pray for those who suffer because of hatred and hard-heartedness. Jesus has set an example for us. Help us to follow him. We pray for those who are injured by acts of violence or natural disaster. Jesus has set an example for us, those who are sick or dying, and for those who are frightened or distraught. Jesus has set an example for us. Help us to follow him. Most holy God, in Jesus Christ, you show us that true glory is in humble service. Renew in us your call to love one another, to welcome the stranger, and to show Christ's mercy in all. Amen.